So shake your hand, brother. What a day it is here to be in the house of the Lord today. I want to say hello to everyone that's online, all my friends online and family that are watching, all the members here that have come out, my neighbor JoJo, Julia, and their son.
Good to have you guys.
James and Kenty, my daughter, and his boyfriend. We got my son Kendall. What a blessing it is. Hallelujah to have my son here, and hallelujah. Great to see everybody back there. Everybody, the church members, Christine, it's good seeing you here. Hope everything is going well with your recovery and your surgery. Julie, it's good seeing you back there. I know you're in that corner back there with the kids. Amanda, it's good having you here too. Everybody, Chuck, Dale, Sarah, Linda, everybody, Nikki, Raynette, good having you. Eric, Mallory. So what a testimony for everybody being here today. I want to start off with just a memory verse. It's going to tie into the prayer of deliverance and praise from David in his older days in Psalm 71. And it's going to be in Isaiah, chapter 49, verse 23. It goes by this: kings shall be your foster fathers, and their queens your nursing mothers. They shall bow down to you with their faces to the earth, and lick up the dust off your feet. Then you will know that I am the Lord, for they shall not be ashamed who wait for me. That's a great memory verse that's going to tie into Psalm 71. I also want to ask, we have a prayer book. I forgot to mention that back there. If anybody has prayer, please, fill it out. Pastor D likes that, to do that. Like I said, all your requests be made known. We'll be happy to pray for everybody that has one. So as we go, I appreciate everything coming out here today, that D's allowing me to get up here today as well. I'm going to start in Psalm 71, and it goes like this. In you, O Lord, I put my trust. Let never be put to shame.
Yes.
And basically what that meaning is, never being ashamed of me. Is basically what David's saying. Hey, I'm not going to be ashamed of Christ. We're going to go in verse 2. Deliver me in your righteousness and cause me to escape. Incline your ear to me and save me. Basically, they're basically saying God's hearing your prayer and God's saving you all the time, people. And that's powerful. That's powerful there. Verse 3. Be strong, my refuge, to which I may resort continually. You have given me the commandment to save me, for you are my rock and my fortress. And that's basically saying be strong in the Lord at all times, people. It doesn't matter what you're going through. Be strong. James, you be strong. Everybody be strong when you need prayer and supplication. Verse 4, deliver me out, oh my God, out of the hand of the wicked, out of the hand of unrighteous and cruel man. And basically what that's saying is deliver you out of the hand of the cruel and wicked people that are going to treat you. They're not always going to treat you right, man. You're going to have people always, they're going to be against you or whatever it may be, but know that you have the Lord on your side at all times.
Amen.
Verse 5, for you are my hope, O Lord God. You are my trust from my youth. That's basically saying hope in the Lord, not man. It doesn't matter how old you are, it could be from little years up till your middle 50s, 60s. You always put your trust in him. Verse 6, by you I've been upheld from birth. You are who took me out of my mother's womb. My praise shall be continually of you. Oh man, what a praise. Continually praises since you've been an infant and you're taken out of your mother's womb. I mean, that's huge and powerful. Verse 7, I've become as a wonder to many, but you are my strong refuge. This is when he's suffering persecution. David's suffering persecution. He knows that, that he's got an almighty Savior that he can trust at any time. Verse 8, let my mouth be filled with your praise and with your glory all day long. Basically giving God the praise and glory all day long for what he's done for you in your life, people. Doesn't matter what it is. You can always reach out and touch him. The old commercial used to be. Remember that commercial, Dean?
Mm-hmm.
So, reach out and touch someone. You can always reach out and call upon him. Verse 9, do not cast me off in time of old age. Do not forsake me when my strength fails. So he's not ever going to discard us. when we go through trials in life. Verse 10, for my enemies speak against me, and those who lie in wait for my life take counsel together. So these are people that are conspiring against you. You know, these are people against David's enemies, saying they're conspiring things up about behind your back. But you know what? You can always pray that off too as well. Verse 11, saying God has forsaken him, pursue and take him, for there is none to deliver him. And that's plotting his destruction, is basically what he's trying to say. Verse 12, O God, do not be far from me. Oh my God, make haste to help me. He's just asking for God. He's asking God for help in any way he can for him. And you know, that's a great thing. And same with all you people out there, online, in here, wherever you got a problem, people, you can ask Jesus to come into your heart and mind. And he'll be there. Right, Chuck Hoos? Yes, sir. So we got verse 13 here. Let them be confounded and consumed, the adversaries of my life. Let them be covered with reproach and dishonor who seek my hurt. That's David. Yes, David's enemies confounded and consumed. And that's a great verse too as well. But here's verse 14 is a great one, people. This goes into the praise mode that David basically is doing. Instead of, you know, being persecuted, now he's going into a praise mode for God. But I will hope continually, I will praise you yet more and more. I mean, it's just more and more praise that he's given our Lord and Savior. 15, my mouth shall tell you of your righteousness and your salvation all day long. Now, once again, it's just more praise that he's given God. 16, I will go in the strength of the Lord God. And that's making mention of the righteousness and the promises. 17, O God, you have taught me from my youth, and to this day I declare your wondrous works. And basically saying he's acknowledging God for everything that he's given him. 17, O God, you have taught me from my youth, and to this day I declare your wondrous works. We just did that, I'm sorry. 18, now, this is also a powerful verse here in 18. Now also, when I'm old and gray-headed, O God, do not forsake me until I declare your strength to this generation. And this is talking about, this is a powerful verse that's leaving a legacy of, or record deliverances. You know, this is going to be what you're going to be remembered by, people. You know, what it's not going to be what you did on this earth or this life. It's going to be what people are going to remember you by as a father, a husband, grandfather, friend, whatever it may be. And that's the most important thing in life, giving back to people. 19, verse 19. Also, your righteousness, O God, is very high. You have done great things, O God. Who is like you? And that's, once again, exalting the Lord at all times. Verse 20. You who have shown me great and severe troubles shall revive me again and bring up me again from the depths of the earth. And that's being forsaken by praising him again all the time. 21, you shall increase my greatness and comfort me on every side. Oh, man. David's basically saying how great his Lord really truly is. People, that's powerful, you guys. Verse 22, I'm almost done now. Verse 22, also with a lute, I will praise you and your faithfulness, oh my God. To you, I will sing with the harp, O Holy One of Israel. And that's basically saying that he's going to praise you from the singing praises of your lips. I mean, you're going to praise God from your lips, proclaiming him. Verse 23, my lips shall greatly rejoice when I sing to you, and my soul which you shall have redeemed. This is singing praise, hymns, you know, songs, whatever it may be, of giving him all the glory and praise. And last but not least, verse 24, my tongue also shall talk of your righteousness all the day long. For they are confounded, for they are brought to my shame, who seek my hurt. And this is, like I said, this is going to be continuing from God's righteousness, for they'll be confounded. Now I just want to do one little quick verse from Psalm 109, verse 3 and 4 to tie into this. And then I'll be done. We'll pray. And Daniel, it's great seeing you here with your kids. I haven't seen you for a long time, brother. It's good having you here too today as well, and the granddaughter. Let's see, we're going to go to Psalm 109. had bookmarked here. Okay, here we go. Psalm 109, verse 3 and 4. To close this thing out. They have also surrounded me with the words of hatred and fought against me without a cause. Oh, Lord, man. People do that to people all the time, and they got problems with people. But you know what? Give it to the Lord. In return for my love, they are my accusers. But I give myself to prayer. And that's an awesome scripture there in Psalm 109, verse 3 and 4. I'd like to close now with a prayer. If we could bow our heads. And is there any people that need prayer at this time? Or, like I said, we have the book over there. Is there any urgent prayer? I guess not. Okay, we can always put it over there. Dear Father, we come today. What a day it is, a beautiful day, to see everybody come out in this joyous service today. And I thank you for bringing my son here today, dear Lord, on even though it's not Father's Day, for him to make an attempt to get here. And it's great to be here. Kenzie, it's great having you and James here. Nicole and Raynette, it's good having you guys here. JoJo and Julie, my neighbors and their son, what a blessing it is to have them here today and to worship with us today as well. And Christine, I'm hoping you're doing great. And if I don't mention you, Julie and the kids, just everybody, I hope is doing well today, Lord. And just give us all the praise and glory, dear Lord. Thank you for all the favor that you've done in my life as a personal testimony. And I'm sure other people can get up here and do the same thing by giving their testimony, dear Lord, of what you've done, all the favor that Pastor D has preached. And I'm just so grateful. Sister Harris, I know you're looking down here, and Grandma, you are too. And I just want to give everybody praise. I want to give God all the glory for everything he's done. As we go today, just have a blessed and beautiful day, people. In Jesus Christ's name, God bless everyone in here. Amen. And amen. Amen.
I'm not sure, but I think he just dismissed us.
Sorry, Maya.
Hey, man, it's good to be in the house of the Lord. Yeah. I want to share with you as we get ready to sing this first song. It's an old hymn. It says, "When We All Get to Heaven." A few days ago when we were out doing drive-through prayer, and Eric and Jay, we were out there, and it was dead as a doornail.
Yeah.
Nobody stopping in. As we were getting ready to leave, matter of fact, the Judy family who had been out with us, they had just gotten in the car, and here comes somebody pulling in. And by the time I finished that one, another car came pulling in. But that person that I talked to was, I'll talk more about this later on, but they said, "Would you just pray that I have an easy life?" And I said, "No, I won't do that." We're not supposed to have an easy life, because if we have an easy life, we'll forget we need God.
Amen.
But as we got to talking, they finally said to me, he said, "I just want to go to heaven." I said, "The thing is, amen, you got to live right here to get there."
Amen.
But ever since that time, this song has been running over my mind, "When We All Get to Heaven." I'm going to ask you, if you can, to stand with me, and we're going to sing that song, "Sing of the Wondrous Love of Jesus."
Amen.
Turn it up. Sorry?
What?
I need to turn it up.
Okay.
Sing his mercy and his grace in the mansion bright and blessed. He'll prepare for us a place when we all get to heaven. What a day of rejoicing that will be when we all while we walk the pilgrim pathway, clouds will overspread the sky. But when traveling days are over, not a shadow, not a sign. When we all get to heaven, what a day of rejoicing that will be. Onward to the streets of gold. When we all get to heaven, what a day of rejoicing that will be. When we all see Jesus, we'll sing and shout the victory. Let us then be true and faithful, trusting, serving every day. Just one glimpse of Him in glory will the toils of life repay. When we all get to heaven, what a day of rejoicing that will be.
Just be honest, and everybody has their own opinions, but I hear people talk, but I can't wait to see the streets of gold, and I can't wait. I just want to see Him.
Yes.
I want to lay my eyes on my Lord and Savior.
Yes. Yes.
We're going to sing a little chorus that I think we need to learn. I keep hearing this. People say, well, if I could just get through. How many know Jesus is not just in heaven waiting on us, but He's up there ever interceding on us, and for us, and He gave us the right to speak to our problems in the name of Jesus.
Amen.
And tell them, remember, we're going to sing that little chorus, in the name of Jesus.
Amen.
Said, it does not say we will have the victory. We have.
Amen.
We
got the victory. We got the victory.
In the name of Jesus, in the name of Jesus, we have the victory. In the name of Jesus, in the name of Jesus, demons will have to flee. In the name of Jesus, we have the victory. In the name of Jesus, in the name of Jesus, demons will have to flee. Who can tell what God can do? Who can tell of His love for you? In the name of Jesus, Jesus, we have the victory.
Amen. Now, if you have that victory, I want to dare you to shout hallelujah. Praise the Lord. We give you glory today. Thank you, Lord, for that victory.
I will praise your name.
Hallelujah.
I will praise your name. I will praise your name and extol you.
Hallelujah.
I will praise your name I will praise your name. I will praise your name as I behold you.
Sing that again.
Yes, Lord. Yes, Lord.
I will praise your name.
Lord, you're worthy.
Yes, you're worthy, Lord.
I will praise your name. I will praise your name and extol you.
Hallelujah.
I will praise your name. I will praise your name. I will praise your name as I behold you.
Hallelujah, Lord, hallelujah.
For your love is never ending and your mercy ever true. I will bless your name, Lord Jesus, for my heart belongs to you.
Thank you, Jesus, thank you.
I will magnify. I will lift on high.
Thank you, Lord Jesus, thank you. I will magnify
on high. Your name, Lord Jesus. I will magnify. I will glorify.
Yeah.
I will lift on high your name, Lord Jesus. For your love is never ending and your mercy ever true. I will bless your name, for my heart belongs to you. I will praise your name. I will praise your name. I will praise your name and extol.
Thank you, Jesus, for everything.
I will praise your name as I behold
all God's favor. Thank you, Jesus.
Hallelujah. Lord, we bless your name
today. Thank you, Jesus. Thank you, Jesus.
We bless your name, Lord Jesus.
Pray for me, dear Lord.
Hallelujah. Hallelujah.
Thank you, Jesus.
Lead me on. Holy Spirit, fill my heart, come flood my soul, lead me on into your presence, touch me, Lord, Jesus, I need you.
Hallelujah, baby, we need him all the time.
Lead me on,
Holy Spirit.
Holy Spirit, fill my heart,
come flood my soul,
come flood my soul.
Hallelujah.
Lead me on into your presence, touch me, Lord Jesus.
We need you all the time, brother, we need you all the time, sir.
Cause I can't live without you. I can't walk this road alone. In my heart I need you. Holy One, come take my hand.
lead me on into your presence.
Oh, yes, Lord. Thank
you. Touch me, Lord.
I'm over my life, my
Jesus, friends. I need
yes, Lord.
You.
I can't wait to see Sister Harris up in heaven.
Because I can't live
I down,
without you. I can't walk this road alone. In my heart, I need you. Holy One, come take my hand, because I can't live.
I can't live, Lord, without you.
Because I can't live without you. I can't walk this road alone. In my heart, I need you. Holy One, come take my hand.
Hallelujah. Hallelujah, Lord.
Holy One, come take my hand.
Amen. Amen.
Holy One, come take my hand.
Hallelujah, Jesus. Hallelujah for everything. Hallelujah. Yes, sir. Amen. Amen. Keep it going, Brother Dila. Amen.
Thank you, Jesus. How many know he's worthy?
Oh, yes, he's worthy. He's worthy all the time. Doesn't matter what your circumstances is, he's worthy.
You are worthy of it all.
You
are worthy of it all. For from you
are all things,
and to you are all things. You deserve the glory. Come on, sing it to him.
Yes, Lord. Yes, Lord. We sing it to you.
You are worthy of it all.
You
are worthy of it all.
Yes, 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 Lord.
For from you are all things, and to you are all things. You deserve the glory. You're worthy,
Lord. Yes, Lord. I give you all the glory.
You are worthy.
I give you all the glory, Lord.
We give you praise today, Lord Jesus.
For all my family,
you're worthy of it all. You're worthy, Lord. For from you are all things, and to you are all things. You deserve the glory. Sing one more time. You are worthy of it all. You are worthy of it all.
Thank you for this opportunity to praise all my friends and family, Lord. Thank you.
For from you are all things, and to you are all things. You deserve the glory.
You deserve it all, Lord. You deserve it all.
Hallelujah. Just give him praise, Lord.
Yes, Lord.
You are worthy, Lord God.
You
Lord, it's not
cancer,
just a song
Lord.
We sing, but Lord, you are worthy.
You take away everything.
Lord, so many times we come, Lord, looking for what we can get, looking for another blessing,
no
another touch.
Is,
but today I just want to touch you today, Lord God.
Yes,
you're
yes.
worthy to be praised. We
yes,
exalt
yes.
your name and
I
lift you on
here.
High.
You know
holy
what?
Are you, Lord.
Awesome God.
Holy are you, Lord.
Thank you.
We give you glory.
Thank you, Jesus. Thank you, Jesus. Thank
you. You are worthy of it all. Yes, you are. Lord.
Yes, you're worthy of it all, Lord.
You are worthy of it all.
You've given us everything. Thank you, Jesus.
For from you are all things, and to you are
beautiful
all
family,
things.
My wife.
You deserve the glory.
Hallelujah.
Hallelujah.
I ask you to
amen. Amen. Would you just give him the best praise you got?
Yeah, amen. 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 Hallelujah. Hallelujah.
Hallelujah.
Thank you, Jesus. Thank you, Jesus.
Hey, man, you can be seated if you can. I don't know about you, but I sense the presence of the Lord in this
amen.
House.
Amen. That's our boy. That's
you know, he's here all the time, but sometimes it's just a special visitation, and I appreciate that. I don't know about anybody else,
You need to learn this. Even when you don't feel him, he's there.
That's right. He's always there.
Learn to walk in that. But in those times where there's a special visitation of his presence, you need to soak it in and take advantage of that while you can. I want to jump into the Word today. I'm also going to be honest. I'm not going to get through this one. I wrote a book this week. But I want to talk about getting to your destiny. How many know you have a destiny?
That's yes, quiet. We got a destiny, brother.
You have a destiny. See, I really believe that is much of the problem in this world today. People are just going through the motions. They're just trying to get by. And you need to understand,
God has a purpose
for your being here. Every one of us, not just in this house, I'm talking about alive on this planet in this day, in this age. God has a purpose.
Amen.
If you have your Bibles, would you turn with me to the book of Genesis, chapter 12? And I want to encourage you as we read through this, keep it open because we're going to come back and visit again in a couple of moments. Genesis chapter 12. That's right at the beginning, folks. If you don't know where Genesis is.
Yes.
Genesis chapter 12. So good to see everybody. And I didn't even say thank you to those that are tuning in online. And I appreciate so much you guys that are in online. And I'm almost hesitant to share this. I'm not going to share names, but it's just amazing. A couple of weeks ago, I shared how giving had been down this last month. It began to pick up some. But, you know, the other day I came to the mailbox and there was a card in there telling me from some friends in Florida said, we just feel like the Lord has told us we need to sow seed in your ministry for a while.
That's right. Amen.
And, you know,
brother,
it's like
amen.
God is moving on the hearts of people. So if you'd like to give,
brother,
the information
all
is there.
The time.
We thank you for those in the house. If you'd like to give, there's a box in the back and one back here. Eric's guarding that box right there. He's looking at don't come near my box. But we appreciate your giving so much. And it doesn't just go to feed or minister here, but we go to feed people, to help people.
Right.
You're being a blessing in this community. That I don't always stand up here and tell you
very
all that you're
doing,
but you're blessing people. In Genesis chapter 12, you're familiar with this story. I'm sure God is calling Abram. It says, now the Lord said to Abram, get out of your country, from your family, and from your father's house, and to a land I will show you. I will make you a great nation. I will bless you and make your name great. And you shall be a blessing.
Amen.
And I will bless those who bless you, and I will curse those who curse you. And in you, all the families of the earth shall be blessed.
Amen, brother.
So Abram departed as the Lord had spoken to him, and Lot went with him. And Abram was 75 years old when he departed from Haran. Then Abram took Sarai, his wife, and Lot, his brother's son, and all their possessions that they had gathered, and the people whom they had acquired in Haran, and they departed to go to the land of Canaan. And so they came to the land of Canaan. How many know God can get you to your Canaan? Come on, I think you're all half asleep already.
No, we ain't asleep.
God can get you to your Canaan. That's your destiny,
amen,
folks.
Brother.
There is a destiny for each and every. I want to say it again. I believe God has a destiny for each one of us.
Yes,
a lot of people tell me, well,
he's
I don't believe I have one. You need to understand the Word of God. God has a calling for you. A destiny simply means this.
Yes.
When you hear this very carefully, because this is important. When you live your life according to the will of Jesus Christ.
Yes, Lord. Thank you.
That's the key. When you live your life according to the will of Jesus Christ, he will get you to your destiny. Everything else is a detour. Are you hearing me? If you are not following his will, if you're not doing what he says, you're on a detour. And you're just prolonging the journey. Now, I guarantee you there's people in this room, people watching online who have asked this question, probably even just recently. Well, why am I even here?
Well, that's right. Come on. I hear it all the time, people.
Is there some meaning to this life? Or are we just here to take up space for a while and then we die?
No,
I want to tell you something. We are all allowed.
Here for a purpose, Lord.
We're all given a certain amount of time that we're here on this earth. And the clock's ticking. The clock is winding down on your story. You know, I hate to say this, but I say it frequently to people. From the moment you were born, you're on your way to die. You need to think about that. We don't know when that time is going to come, but we are on our destiny toward death. So we don't need to waste time. I've had people say to me, well, if God would let me do this, this, and this, then I'll serve him. No, you're missing the point, because if you're not serving him, you're wasting your time. You're spinning your wheels. Ever been stuck in a mud and spinning your wheels, and all you're doing is getting your car dirty or your truck dirty and throwing mud on people around you, and you're not going anywhere? And there's a lot of people living life that way. But I want to share with you that not only do people have destinies, I believe families have destinies. Hello? Your family has a destiny. And if we're, well, I don't want to go there right now, I'll save that for later. Realize what you do, how you influence your family, determines the destiny of the family. Hello? Boy, it got real quiet all of a sudden. The shout just disappeared out of the place. Man. What you're doing with your family determines your destiny. But guess what? I believe there's also a destiny for churches. Hello?
Amen.
There is a destiny for the church. I want you to notice something that many times we miss. We just read that God called Abram. But let's, if you still have your Bible, if you're on the internet, I can't help you how far back you got to go. But if you're in your Bible, just go back one page probably, because we're going to look at chapter 11. I want to read something that I guarantee you, you've read it, but did it register what's happening? In chapter 11, verses 31 and 32 says something very key. It says in verse 31 of chapter 11, and Terah took his son Abram. Wait a minute. Who's Terah? That's Abram's father, Abraham's father. And Terah took his son Abram and his son, grandson Lot and the son of Haran and his daughter-in-law Sarah, his son Abram's wife. And they went out from Ur of the Chaldeans to go to the land of Canaan. And they came to Haran and dwelt there. So the days of Terah were 205 years. And Terah died in Haran. There's something powerful in this verse that I want you to see today that most of us skim right over. Terah is Abram's father. Where was Terah going? To Canaan. God had spoken to Terah and told him, take your family and go to Canaan. But it says in that text, to allow me to give you the Garrett translation, on the way he found a comfortable place. He found a place that was pretty, a place there was peace there, and he settled there, and he died there, never reaching the promise of God.
Amen.
Oh, you guys are so quiet. If I have to come, I promise you, if I have to come out there and amen me every time I need an amen, this is going to be twice as long today.
Amen, brother, amen.
There we go.
Hallelujah. There we go, man. Hallelujah.
He was on his way to Canaan. God had spoken to him, take your family, and he told this man, Terah, that I want you to go to Canaan, the promised land. He didn't do it, but watch what happens. When he failed to fulfill his destiny, God took his destiny and gave it to somebody else.
Oh, yes.
He'll do it.
That's he right. gave it to his son, Abram. And Abram then picks up his family. We talk about him and Lot, and we act like that's it. But if you read and study this out, they took 1,000 people with them on this journey. We start serving the Lord.
Come on in.
And he starts giving us a direction and a vision for our lives. But somewhere along the way... Yep. I keep hearing words when they fire in my mouth. Somewhere along the way. I'm sorry. Somewhere along the way, something happened. He lost sight of where he was going and got comfortable where he was.
Yep.
Church, hear me. Don't get comfortable where you are. God's got more for you. He's got so much more for you. But we settle. Listen, here's the interesting thing. God did not condemn him for this.
Right.
Read it. God still blessed him. He was blessed and lived a prosperous life, but he never reached his purpose.
Yep.
He never saw the fulfillment of his destiny, and it was handed on to his son.
Amen.
There's a lot of people. I'm sorry, I got music going in my head today.
That's all right.
And I'm going to shock some people because a lot of people think all you need to do is listen to Christian music. I like rock.
Come on now.
And a few years ago, there was a song out by a group called Finger 11. The name of the song was One Thing. The song is about a guy who is tempted to have an affair. And he's talking in this song, if I traded it all, if I gave it all away for one thing, just for one thing. I want to tell you, many of us have traded our destiny for one thing. It may be a job.
Come on, Jesus.
It may be somebody that you think you're in love with and you want to marry that person, and it's not God's appointed person for you.
Come on now.
For some people, it's drugs or alcohol. And for some people, it can go into so many things. It's about accumulating wealth. Hear me, nothing wrong with having wealth.
But if your
goal is focused on wealth, you're going to let that one thing distract you from your destiny.
Yeah.
See, the enemy of your soul will try to get you to trade everything
for
one thing.
Come on now.
He tries to sidetrack you. He tries to get you off in a different direction. I got to get that song out of my head now.
Amen.
The Bible says Terah died in that place as he settled there. He traded his destiny for a life of comfort. Oh, hear me, church.
Yeah.
The reason I told that person I would not pray for an easy life is that easy life will distract you from what you're supposed to be doing.
Yeah, come on, man.
That easy life will cause you to give up on your career goals. It will cause you to give up on family. That will cause you to give up on serving the Lord. And we could go on and on about things that will cause you to give it up. Terah died because even though he knew where he was supposed to go, he knew he was on the right path, he found a place, well, it's comfortable here.
Yeah.
I could settle here.
Yeah.
Preach.
Amen.
See, the life of Terah speaks to me anyway. I hope it speaks to you of missed opportunity.
Yes, it does.
Of missed blessing. See, how many know you can have a good life and miss out on a great life?
Yes, Lord.
How many know you can have blessings but miss out on all the abundance of blessings that God has for you? See, I'm going to tell you something that somebody needs. We think the devil is always out there with a pitchfork trying to stab you. No, he's trying to distract you.
That's right.
He's trying to keep you from getting to your destiny.
Yes.
When Terah settled, again, I want to say this. God didn't cut him off. God didn't say, "Yup, you ain't going to do what I want, kick you to the curb."
Thank you, Father.
He didn't do that.
Yeah.
But Terah missed a golden opportunity to get the children of Israel to establish the land of Canaan as it was supposed to. I'm going to tell you something that you need to hear today. Because people say all the time, well, if it's meant to be, it'll happen. That is a lie from the pits of hell. Because the enemy, all he wants to do is keep it from happening.
Yeah.
And he doesn't always bring trouble into your life. Sometimes he brings comfort.
Amen.
Sometimes there will be peace. I've watched people do this over and over and over. Well, I'm just trying to keep peace in my family, Pastor. And if I go to church, it disrupts things.
Yeah.
Uh-oh.
Yeah.
It's going to disrupt things because the devil don't like that.
That's right.
Come on.
So we've got to determine that we're going this direction. Yeah. God will not make you do it. Oh, somebody hear me.
Yeah.
God will not make you. He lays the choice before you.
Yes, and you choose
or you reject.
Yep.
And when we reject, he moves on.
Oh, yes, he does.
Well, a lot of people don't want to hear that, but God, isn't that exactly what Jesus told the people? So when you go into a city and you present the gospel to them and they won't receive it, shake the dust from your sandals and leave.
Yeah.
And that shows us exactly the way God is. God will try his very best to bring you to that place, but he will not make you. But his will be accomplished.
That's what I want to
get to today. God will raise somebody up. He will raise up another person. He will raise up another church. I've wrestled with this for 3 days, whether or not to say it, so buckle up, all right? You guys are all going to be okay, but it's going to be other people here that's going to get upset with me.
Come on.
My wife and I were laying in bed last night trying to figure out exactly when this was. It was somewhere around 2006 or 2007. Not really sure. My son's back there. Do you happen to remember when Dinko was with us? Remember Dinko came from Bulgaria? He was in high school. I know it was in that period. It doesn't really matter except for this. If you remember, right next to Pizza Hut, there's a big building there that used to be the distribution center for Nair.
Yeah.
I had one of my dearest friends, Jake Popejoy, and another friend, Dinko, I'll try it, Zagerovich, from Bulgaria. And we took them to Nair, and we were seeing what things we could get, and we shipped it to Dinko in Bulgaria for his missions that he's doing there. But we were standing in that warehouse. Now, if you've never been in that place, even now, it's a massive building. But what I'm going to say, I've got a couple of witnesses that were here that will remember this. Way back then, I was standing in that place, and Jake walks over to me and said, "Darrell, what's wrong with you?" I said, "Lord just gave me a vision." He said, "Well, what did he show you?" I said, "I saw a church in this place." And I said, "Right back there, they had some loading docks back there, places to work on their trucks." And I said, "I see a place where we're going to have a place where single moms can bring their cars in and we'll fix them for them."
Mm, geez.
And right over there, I said, "There's going to be a daycare center." And I laid this whole thing out for them. And Jake said, "I believe that was from the Lord." And that next week, I went to my church and I told them, "Church, God said we're to put a church." And I told them where, and they laughed at me. I said, "I'm telling you, God said there's going to be a church there, and we need to follow after this." How many knows what went in that place?
A church.
A few years later, a church came in there, didn't they? And guess what they did? They put a daycare center and a thrift store exactly where I said they would be.
Come on,
and I'm not trying to pat me on the back. I'm saying God spoke to me, and people said, "We will not go."
Yeah.
So what did he do? He gave the destiny to somebody
else. Yeah.
Come on,
man.
I'm not trying to brag on this. I'm trying to say, what a missed opportunity.
Amen.
That was for us to be in that and have that harvest. And God was ready to bless the church. But people said, "But we just remodeled this building. We're comfortable here. We don't want to go into all that expense. And how will we afford it?" And I said, "We won't, but he can."
Amen, man. Amen.
I don't want to belabor that point, but I want you to get this. God gave a destiny. And when we refused it, he brought somebody from Peoria in to fill that destiny. Because God's will be accomplished.
That's right.
Now, I want you to see yourself in this situation. I'm trying to be very careful here, but it's been a couple weeks ago.
Man, come on, man.
I get that same prayer request a lot. Would you just pray that I have an easy life?
Yeah.
This was a young girl. She's just a teenage girl. She didn't even pull in. Actually, she was in the passenger seat. They pulled up the stoplight, and she said, "Would you pray for me?" And I said, "What do you need, hon?" She gave me her name, and she said, "I just want you to pray that life would get easy for me." And I said, "Honey, I can't do that." And I ran over and grabbed her hand and I prayed for her. But I got to thinking since then, how many times I've had that same prayer request, pray that I have an easy life. We live in a society that the devil has duped into believing what you want is an easy life. An easy life will cause you to get weak and flabby.
That's right.
Not only physically, but spiritually.
Amen.
Quit praying for an easy life and pray, "Lord God, would you give me the strength I need? Would you give me the determination I need?" I want you to get this. I think you all know it, but it needs to be said. God is a God of faith.
Oh, yes,
yes, he is.
Matter of fact, the Bible says that without faith, it is impossible to please him.
Yeah.
Without faith, we can't do anything. You can go through the emotions. I want to go there, and I hope I don't anger people, but
come on now,
it is what it is.
That's right.
Just this week, I saw something, and I'll be honest, I was happy. I told my wife, I said, isn't this awesome? In the United Methodist Church, if you've been paying attention, the United Methodist Church about a month and a half ago now decided that they were going to endorse homosexual priests. In this last week, week and a half, 1 million people left the United Methodist Church.
Come on.
Come on. Because you know what? A lot of people, I guarantee you, they looked at it and said, "But that's my church. I want to fight for my church. And you're weak. I believe in that. But there is a point in time we say, no, that's not my destiny. That's not where I'm going. So you need to look at things and realize, just because somebody, they could stand behind a sacred desk and tell you something, if it doesn't line up with God's will and God's plan for your life, reject it.
Amen.
Come on.
Amen.
That's right.
Amen. Looking at the story of Abraham. Abram at this point, but Abraham. I want to look at five dynamics or five keys that were operating in his life to help him to get to this place of destiny. I'm probably not going to get through all these, and if not, I'll pick them up next week. But I want to talk about this for a moment. The first dynamic that he had operating his life is he had the ability to hear from God. I don't know how to say this, because I don't want to sound like, oh, he thinks he's better than people. I don't think it that way at all, but I can't tell you the number of times I've sat in churches, in Sunday school classes, and in services, and I've heard the preacher pray that Abraham had never heard from God before. And I want to say that is not true. Mm-hmm. We just told you that Terah had heard from God. Mm-hmm. And God was giving him direction. I do believe he sowed that into his son. Mm-hmm. But here's the thing I want you to understand. In that time, there was no churches to go to. There were no preachers. There were no books to read to steer and guide them along the way. How did they get guidance from the Lord? They heard from him. He spoke to them, and they heard from him. No magazines, no Christian radio stations. God. And I have people challenge me all the time and say, you claim to hear from God. I've never heard from God. I'm going to tell you, there's something missing in your life if you're not hearing from the Lord.
Amen.
And I'm not trying to condemn anybody. I'm trying to help you along the way, because you need to learn to hear from God.
Amen.
He's speaking all the time. You've heard me use the illustration many times. If we brought a radio in here and we tuned it in, we'd hear Willie Nelson singing right now. And we'd hear somebody else singing. We might hear some rap music, because you have to have a radio station or a radio to tune into that station to hear it.
Yeah.
Spiritually, there's a lot of people who are not tuned in.
No, a lot of lost people.
You've got to get to this place. I'm not just talking lost people. I'm talking Christian people.
Yeah, come on now.
People that if they get everything they get from what the pastor says.
Amen.
Or what some favorite author says. You need to learn to get in the Word of God and tune your spiritual beings into your spiritual ears into the Father.
Yes,
hear what he's got to say. Abram had the ability. Think about this. All the Bible says is, and God said to Abraham, get your family and all of your possessions and get out. And he didn't even tell them where they were going. Think about this. He said, go to the place I will show you. Here's the problem many of us have. We want God to lay it out, A, B, C, D, E, F, G, all the way down, and then we'll step. And God says, get up and move, and I'll show you where to go.
Amen.
You got to start walking before you're going to get
Amen.
The next instruction.
Amen.
See.
Come on now.
Come on, brother.
Good.
Again, remember this. This is not just Abram and a small little crowd. He's got 1,000 people there. They've been living in this place for quite some time now. His father brought them there. They lived there, prospered there. He dies, and after that time, the Lord speaks to him, and Abram gets up and says, God told me we got to go. Now, I don't know the exact numbers. I can't find it anywhere, but they didn't all follow him, but 1,000 people did.
Amen.
1,000 people said, this man has heard from the Lord, and they chose to follow him based on what? I heard from God. Come on, somebody hear me.
Amen.
See, he heard God speak, he believed what he heard, and he obeyed. Mm-hmm. Well, there's the key. There's a lot of people who have heard, and they might even believe, but they're not willing to obey. Because they start in with, well, what if I fail?
Yep.
Well, what if you don't?
That's right. All the time.
That's kind of a no-brainer, isn't it? I might fail, but you might not.
Right.
See, we've got to get to this place. See, it implies something to me Adam had been hearing from God prior to this time, because it wasn't like this voice just spoke to him and all of a sudden he said, oh, that's the Lord. No, he's been in communication with the Lord many, many times. Let me help somebody out. Because a lot of people think that God says, hey, Eric, I got something to tell you. It's not how it works.
No.
You're driving down the road and the Lord says, I want you to go over there and speak to JoJo.
Amen. Amen.
Tell JoJo I love him today.
That's right. Amen.
And we choose to obey that.
Yeah.
Or reject that.
That's right.
See, and God starts with those small things, and he tells us, I want you to go over there and see that guy. He's hungry. Would you go over there and feed him and tell him that I love him so much that I sent you to do this? Mm-hmm. And when we start learning to take those baby steps, then he can say, get your family.
Amen.
And go.
Yeah. Amen, brother.
I will be honest with you. I want to share a story. Some of you have heard me talk about this before. That guy back there with them three babies, that's my boy. When he was not much bigger than that littlest one, we were living in Tennessee.
Yes.
Beautiful country. Didn't have winters like this. I mean, we literally have left there, grilled on our front porch, got in the car and drove back up here to you knuckleheads in snow. But we had moved to a place we lived on. Beautiful house, had a lake out the back door, literally as close out the back door as where Eric's sitting right now. Amen. Not Eric. God was blessing us. My boss, where I had been working, had just accepted a new position, and the director came and offered me a job. I got curious the other day, because it's been a long time ago. That was 33 years ago. And the amount they offered me today would have been $139,000. And I said, no, because God called me to move to Illinois, to a little town I'd never heard of called Bridgeport, and pastor a church that had been locked up for 2 years. My brother-in-law, who raised me, came down to help us move. He pulled the U-Haul into the lane where we lived at, and he saw the house on the lake. He said, have you lost your ever-loving mind?
Yep.
He's a pastor. And my daddy. And he says, have you lost it? I said, JT, I said, I've been waiting. It's time for me to go pastor this church. He said, you're crazy, Daryl. You've got a career. You've got a nice house. Stay here. It's in your beautiful weather. But I had to go. Why? Because the Lord spoke to me.
Yeah, that's right.
He said, I want you to go to Bridgeport.
Go.
Little bitty old town. I don't have time to go in and tell you all this, but God moved in a miraculous way. The first week we started there, I'm being real, it was so bad that when they opened the doors, there was mold on the old wood pews, and I went and scraped the mold off the pews. The carpet was awful. The windows were about to fall out, but God blessed, and we began to grow. We remodeled that place, and it was gorgeous. God comes in and speaks again and says, I want you to go to Danville. I'm like, I don't want to go to Danville. Come on, I want you to hear my heart today. My wife will tell you, where's she at? She can tell you, I'm telling the absolute truth. My state overseer at that time, my boss, if you will, said, Daryl, there's a church in Danville. The pastor's retired, and I want you to go there. And I said, no. God was blessing. We were growing. We had such talent in there that some of the boys were there, not once, but twice. Played at the double wards that came out of that little bitty town of 1,100 people. God was blessing us. We went to the church, and it was horrible. Am I exaggerating? It was horrible. And the house was worse. I'm not exaggerating one bit. We walked into the kitchen and went sticking to the carpet.
Oh, man.
And I'm like, I don't want to go to Danville. And I fought the Lord for 3 weeks. One Sunday afternoon, I preached that morning, and we ate. In our house, we had a couple of bedrooms upstairs, and that's where I would get alone to study and pray. And I went up. The Lord began to speak to me, and I came and laid down in the bed next to my wife. And I said, honey, I said, we're supposed to go to Danville. She said, I've known that for 3 weeks. I've been waiting for you to get on board.
Amen.
My point is this. We're not always going to like what God tells us to do.
That's right, man. That's right.
But when we went to Danville, the church exploded in growth. People were coming. We don't know how they, I'm being real. I don't know how they came. People ask me all the time, how did you grow a church? I have no clue. God did it. People just kept showing up, and we had a youth group that met on Friday nights that had over 60 teenagers coming to the youth group. God was blessing. And all of a sudden, the Lord says, I want you to go to West Frankfort. And I'm like, I don't want to go to West Frankfort. Are you hearing what I'm telling you? I'm just like you.
Yeah.
Sometimes we hear from God, yeah, and we don't like what he says.
Yeah.
But God doesn't want us comfortable.
No, he doesn't.
No.
He wants somebody that will say, you know what, it's not comfortable, but I will do what you asked me to do.
That's right.
That's how you get to your destiny.
That's right.
Abram had the ability to hear from God. See, I get really concerned when I have church people and people that I know telling me, I've never heard from God. I might as well throw it out there. You need to hear this. The psychiatrists think I'm crazy. I know you all know I'm crazy, right? Every time I've ever gone to talk to one of them, you have to do them for job interviews and stuff. And they said, I hear you talk to God. And I said, I sure do. Mm-hmm. Did you hear him? I said, I hear him. Mm-hmm. And every one of them says, the man hears voices. I don't care what they think.
Come on now.
That's right.
See, hear me. Somebody get what I'm about to tell you. The flesh can never comprehend the spiritual matters. They'll think you're off your rocker. They'll think you're inside out, upside down, and backwards. The Bible says, and God said to Abraham, get up and go, and they went. Now help me say this the right way, Lord. Going to church is not enough for you.
No.
Amen.
You've got to get this. I've had people say, I don't care what you do the rest of the week as long as you're in church on Sunday. I care.
Right.
Yeah.
Because just going to church does nothing but give you religion.
Yeah.
You have to learn what it means to hear from the Lord. Mm-hmm. Get in his word, and the Holy Spirit will confirm within you. If going to church is not accompanied by an ongoing daily relationship, yes, with God,
right,
you've missed it.
Yeah, sir.
I want to say that again because you've got to hear that. If going to church, I want to say it's a good thing. I think it's an important thing to go to church. But if going to church is not accompanied with a daily, ongoing relationship, yeah, where you hear from the Father and the Father hears from you,
yeah,
you're missing it.
Right.
I have people tell me all the time, I've never heard the voice of God. You're just not listening.
Come on now.
That's right.
The more you hear him, the more you're going to know who he is. The Bible says, be still.
Yeah.
And
yeah,
know,
know, yeah,
that he is God.
Yeah.
Some of you can't stand still long enough to hear from God.
Hmm.
You're always one thing after another trying to stir things up and keep things exciting. You know what? Read Psalm 23 and let it sink
in. Right.
There is a peace that is found in stillness. Because that's where God speaks to us. You've got to get away. You know, there are times, I'm not going to sit here and tell you I don't, but there are times I will hear from God when I'm in a group like this or when it's my wife and I, but more times than not, I got to get alone.
Yeah.
Some of us can't stand being alone.
Huh.
Yeah. I'm going to say it, it's because you don't like yourself. I'm being real. Yeah. You don't like yourself enough to spend time alone.
Yep.
And when you spend that alone time, and that's when God will speak to us.
Oh,
because,
yes,
see,
oh,
God's,
yes,
plan is to walk with you and talk with you. Remember that song we used to sing? And he walks with me, and he talks with me, and he tells me I am his own.
Yeah.
Yes, Lord.
Thank you.
We need to learn that again, to learn to walk with him and talk with him. See, in John chapter 16, let me share this real quick. Verse number 13 says this, I'm reading from the New King James. It says, however, when he, the Spirit of truth, has come, he will guide you into all truth. Wait a minute, how is he guiding you? He's guiding us to all truth, but how is he guiding? He's speaking to you.
Yeah.
The Holy Spirit will guide you into all truth, for he will not speak on his own authority, but whatever he hears, he will speak. Let that sink in. Whatever the Holy Spirit is saying to you, he has heard. Who'd he hear it from? the Father and the Son.
Yeah.
You know what that says? This hit me about a week and a half ago when I had a shouting time in my living room. If the Holy Spirit speaks what he says or what he hears, that means they're talking about me in heaven.
Amen.
Come on,
man.
They're talking about you in heaven. It's not a mystery. God has a plan. The Father and the Son are talking, and the Holy Spirit comes as the messenger to lead you into all truth. But the problem is, most of us don't stop to listen.
Right.
Notice what Jesus says. He said that when the Holy Spirit speaks, he only speaks
what
he has heard. Now, I want to make this abundantly clear because there's a great deception in a lot of churches today. Because they will say, the Holy Spirit told me. And if the Holy Spirit told you something that is not in the Word, that's not the Holy Spirit.
Right.
Because he will only say what he's heard from the Father and the Son.
That's right.
That's right.
Hello, that's a freebie. You can tuck that one away, chew on it later on.
Amen.
I get really concerned because I hear people saying, well, the Holy Spirit told me, and they go do things that are absolutely contrary to the Word of God. It became real popular back in the 90s. Pray to God we never see this again. People would come to church and they would say, well, the Holy Spirit told me I'm married to the wrong person. I need to divorce them and marry that one. That's not the Holy Spirit.
No.
The Holy Spirit is not going to bring confusion and disruption and violate God's word ever. Oh, let me get moving. I know when that's meddled too far. If the Father and the Son are speaking about you in heaven, it means there's a plan for you.
That's right.
Thank you, Lord.
Come on, let that sink in. It means there's a direction for your life. There's a purpose for your life. Here's where it's going to get rough. I don't know anybody in here doing it. I pray you're not, but if you are, hear me. If you're looking at your horoscope, stop it now.
Amen, brother. Amen. It's evil. Amen.
I've had people argue with me, Brother Eric, and say, oh, there's nothing wrong with it.
No.
Well, we're going to see what the Word of God says about it, right?
All right.
I've heard people say, well, there's no harm. It's just, a lot of people say, well, it's in fun. Well, if it's in fun, why are you doing it?
That's right.
But here's the thing. People become fascinated with astrology and with the stars and horoscopes, and there are people, I know people who will not live their life until they've read their horoscope every day.
Yeah.
And they go to psychic readers and all these different stupid things. Because here's the bottom line. Hear me carefully. You're saying, I can't hear from the Holy Spirit, so let me hear from what they got to say.
Yeah.
You're seeking guidance from somebody other than the Lord himself.
That's right.
You say, oh, you're just making that up. Well, let's just see. I could go through a whole list. I don't have them all, but there's several places in the Bible where it warns us, don't see the mystics and the soothsayers. But here's one I want you to zero in on. It's found in Isaiah chapter 47. Yeah. This is what God thinks about those astrologers and the horoscopes. It says, Then Isaiah, the prophet, spoke to the astrologers, and he mocks them. He says, let the astrologers come forward, these stargazers who make predictions month by month. Let them save you from what's about to come. God says, you think that they've got something for you? All right, go do what they say, and let's see what happens. That's exactly what he's saying to us there. If you're falling prey to that, and you say, oh, it's innocent, it's fun. No, it's not. You're opening a portal to demonic spirits. You need to stay away from that stuff. You don't need a horoscope because you have a Holy Spirit speaking to you.
Amen.
There's no better guidance than that you're going to get. A horoscope is going to lie to you. It will cause you to do things you're going to regret. I don't have time. I'll hit that another day. I want to say this again. I said it a while ago, but we need to hear this. Worldly wisdom can never understand spiritual matters.
Amen.
That's your flesh. The flesh looks at it. Your good friends that are not Christians, that are not spirit-filled, they will look at you and say, that doesn't make any sense. That preacher, he's trying to manipulate you. No, I'm trying to give you the Word of God.
Yeah.
Because the Word of God is what you can stand on. But we go out and listen to what some knucklehead who has never listened to the voice of God in their life trying to tell you which way. How's their life going?
Come on now. That's right.
Isn't it amazing how many people seek marital counseling from divorced people?
Come on.
Yeah.
Come on. I that's meddling, isn't it? The Holy Spirit speaks to us. Jesus says it this way. Ask yourself, why would he say this if he didn't mean it? My sheep know my voice.
Yep.
You can know his voice. See, all these other voices are crying out. And I'll hear stuff. I'm telling you honestly, sometimes I'm up here preaching, I'll hear something. I'm like, get out of here, devil. Is he trying to get me to slip up and say something stupid?
Yep. There you go, man.
You have to know the difference, because you'll hear something that even sounds good. And it's not the voice of God. The Holy Spirit talks with us, and he tells us, I got a destiny for you. I got a purpose for you. I want to tell somebody today, you've got a destiny.
Oh, yeah.
Let me come on up. I'm going to stop right there, and we'll pick up with point two next week.
Yeah.
Somebody hear me. Close your eyes just for a minute. I don't like doing this very much, but I want you concentrating on nothing but the Lord right now. You may think you don't, but God says you have a purpose.
Yes. Thank you.
You have a plan. Doesn't mean everybody's going to be great in this earth scheme of things. The Bible says that the first shall be last, and the last shall be first.
Yeah.
God doesn't rank things the way we rank things. Being great in the kingdom of God doesn't mean you're a superstar. Nobody may ever know your name.
That's right.
But be great in the kingdom of God.
That's right. Doesn't matter anyway.
Somebody hear me. God knows where you are right now. And he's saying, how long are you going to keep trying it your way? How long are you going to keep listening to these false voices? When are you going to listen to my voice? I have a plan for you. I have a purpose, and there are plans to prosper you. Plans to take you to places you can't get to on your own. We've been speaking about God saying, I want to pour out my favor on you, but you won't let me. Julia, look at me a minute. It's okay if I share what we talked about the other day. Julia back there, I'm not going to go into details. That's her life. She's been to hell and back this week. Attack after attack. I stopped by to see her the other day, and she said, Pastor, I remember you saying last week to get up every morning and say, I'm blessed. I'm prosperous in the name of Jesus. And she said, I began saying that. I'm not going to go into it. It's her story. It doesn't need to be shared, but blessings began to unfold.
Oh, yes.
People states away from here reached out with a helping hand. People ministering to her. And you know what? Life's still hard right now. But I stood in her kitchen the other day, and I looked at her face, and it was just beaming. She said, I'm blessed.
Yes, thank you, Jesus.
See, you need to understand something. Being blessed doesn't mean all your problems are gone.
Yes, Jesus.
Still got a car got to be fixed. Still got other issues going on in life, but I'm blessed.
Yes.
Somebody hear me. Because the devil comes along and says, that preacher says you're blessed, and the car broke down. And that preacher says you're blessed, and this has happened, and that's happening.
Yes,
he distracts us from it. You're blessed because Christ lives in you.
Amen.
If I die today, I'm blessed because I know where I'm going.
Amen.
That's the blessing, folks.
Yes.
Somebody, you need to hear this. The problems are not going to go away just because you say, Lord, I trust you. And it's not always going to be a check coming to mail.
Oh, yeah. Thank you.
But God is faithful and true.
Yeah.
And I'm trying to tell somebody today, you need to hear him, not this preacher. You need to hear from him. He says, are you going to trust me or not? Father, I've done the best that I know to do today. Lord, I hardly touched the surface of this destiny thing, but Lord, I just ask, Lord God, that you would help somebody realize they're not here by accident. They're not on this world by accident. They're not here because of a failure in a broken down marriage or relationship. But Father, they're here because you got a purpose for them. You got a plan to use them, not for their benefit, but for yours, to glorify the name of Jesus Christ. Father, I pray today you help somebody to realize that you love them. You love them. And Lord God, those whom you love are truly blessed. And Lord, if we will just begin to take those first steps, that you'll meet us there. Help them to take a step. Somebody hear me right now. The problem is, we're just saying, if God wants this for me, why don't he just do it? It's up to you. You have to respond.
Right.
Remember what I said a while ago about your destiny? He will not force it upon you. But when you take the first step, he will be there with you from that point on. Father, help somebody right now. If you're in this room, if you're watching online, you can't come here, but right where you are, if you say, I need prayer, would you just hold up your hand? I'm not going to call you out. I'm not going to do anything to embarrass anybody. I just want to pray for you. Amen. 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 Keep them up for a minute. They're going up everywhere. I want to. Thank you, Jesus.
Thank you, Jesus.
Father, I thank you for those that are online. I may not see them, but you see that hand. Father, in the name of Jesus, some of these folks, I know what's happening in their lives, but Lord, some I don't. But I don't have to know. Lord, I just ask right now, Lord God, that you would prove yourself once again. Or just as I heard from Julie the other day, that once she took the step and started saying the words, the blessings began to unfold. Help them to realize, Lord, I'm going to take a step of faith. Father, help them to realize it's not the quest. We're not the answer. It's not Pastor T, but it's Jesus Christ.
Amen, Lord.
Lord, we look to you in our situation. Lord, give somebody wisdom beyond their own. Help them to see the answer, Lord God, and to navigate this. Help them to know when to walk away and when to step forward. Father, I just want to give you the thanks and praise. I believe right now that, Lord, you're already moving on behalf of several of these that raise their hands. And before this week's out, we're going to hear a testimony of what you've done. Father, there's some that maybe didn't raise their hand, but they're searching, they're struggling right now. Would you be their peace? Would you be their comfort? Be their guide? And Father, I give you the thanks in advance. I thank you for what you're going to do. Work the miraculous in their lives in the name of Jesus. In Christ's name, I pray. I'd be amiss if I don't do this. I just feel, if there's anybody here that you need prayer right now, come on up here and we're going to anoint you with oil. We're going to pray. That may be new to you, but the Bible says, let them call for the elders of the church and anoint them with oil. The prayer of faith shall make them whole.
Amen.
Anybody? Wait just 1 minute. We're going to get out of here. All right. We're done. Father, I thank you for this day. I thank you for your word. And I, Father, that we can stand on your word. Lord, your word never fails. And I thank you for that. I thank you for your people, Lord God. Those that are here in this room, those that are watching online, I pray your blessings upon their life this week. I pray protection. Keep them safe, Lord God, until the next time we gather again. In Christ's name we pray. Amen.
Amen.
God bless you.
Amen.